Hello, welcome back to How to Learn a Language. This week, it is an interview episode that I recorded a good few months back now. And this is me speaking with Fabio Cerpelloni, who is an Italian, has spent a lot of time in English-speaking countries. And so we talk about his experience learning English, what it was like, and how he found that, and about teaching and how to keep interested in languages and how he has managed to get to such a strong level in a language. So yes, enjoy this episode, have a little listen, and as always, all of the usual podcast things, subscribe, like, share, follow, all of that stuff, and I will see you very soon. All right, thank you, enjoy. Fabio, hello, welcome.
Hi, Lindsay.
Hi, I want to give you a little chance, first of all, to introduce yourself.
Sure. So I'm an Italian teacher of English. I started learning English when I was in my early 20s. I'm 36 now. And I then started teaching English in 2015 when I got my first teaching certificate, the CELTA, Cambridge CELTA. I teach English. I am a writer also. I'm a blogger. I love writing. Writing is my happy place. I write in English because I don't know. Actually, I've never written in Italian. I've never written blogs, or I only write emails sometimes and WhatsApp messages in Italian. The rest is all in English. So articles, my academic assignments, everything is in English. And yeah, I'm just a teacher of English who loves writing. Yeah.
Excellent. I'm really intrigued already. There's a couple of things I want to pick up on. It sounds like a lot of your life is lived through English in terms of work and things like that now. When did that become a thing? You said you started learning in your early 20s?
Yeah, I started learning English when I was 24. Well,
Okay.
learning English seriously, at least,
Yeah.
I should
So you'd
say.
done bits in school.
Yeah, the
Yeah.
usual,
Yeah.
it didn't work. It was
Yeah.
all grammar. It didn't, I never spoke a word of English in class. But then I moved to London in 2011. I had a job at pret-a-manger. I don't know if you're
Nice, of
familiar with it.
course.
Yeah, of
Yes,
course.
yeah.
So I had colleagues from all over Europe, all over the world, and I started speaking English there. And I realized that it wasn't just a boring subject. It wasn't just a set of a group of grammar rules to learn, but it was actually something that I could use to make friends. And I fell in love. I fell in love with learning. Not languages, but English. Like it was my thing. So it became a passion. Then I realized that I could teach it. So I realized that there was this course called the CELTA course. And I thought, wow, so this is what I want to do now. I want to become a teacher. Then I moved to Australia. I lived 2 years in Australia. In London, I spent two years there. Oh, well, 1 year and a half. Too busy to like London was great, but 1 year and a half was enough, especially if you work for pret-a-manger, which is like Starbucks.
When you went to Australia, you were like straight to the outback, complete opposite. No, not
Not
quite.
really. Well, after 1 month, yes, because I landed in Adelaide. I spent 1 month in Adelaide, working in an Italian restaurant, and then I went to the outback picking mandarins and oranges. It was hard work, but it was more relaxing. And there in Australia, I kept on, improving my English. I didn't take courses. I took some courses in London, but in Australia, I didn't. I used to use the grammar books, self-study books. I used to listen a lot to other people. speak. And then I moved to New Zealand after 2 years in Australia, and that's where I became a teacher, because I did my training course there, and I started teaching English there in Auckland, New Zealand, for 2 years. And then I came back. I traveled a little bit in Southeast Asia for 6 months, and then I came back to Italy, and I'm here now.
Yeah. Nice.
And end of fun.
End of story. Full stop. And that's interesting. And so now teaching English in Italy, is that online? In Italy, in person?
I started teaching at the British Council Milan.
Mm-hmm.
I was a full-time teacher there for 4 years, and it wasn't online. Then after the pandemic hit, we all went online, and I decided, okay, I want to teach online because it's, you know, I don't have to commute. I can reach not only Italians, but many other people. And I then resigned from the British Council. I started building my thing. It didn't really work. I think I wasn't patient enough. I tried for 2 years, but then now I'm kind of, I don't have many clients, private clients. I still work for universities and the British Council because I came back. But I'm in the process now of figuring out what to do. I really like writing, so I'm trying to find more writing gigs. Yeah. I write for, I don't know if I can say this, but yeah, I think I can, for Holly Richards, you know,
uh-huh.
Story Learning.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I'm the ghostwriter for Story Learning for the English part of the blog.
Ah, okay, interesting. And so I'm really intrigued by, I need you to clarify the like timeline for me. So you started learning English seriously kind of mid-20s. What did you say, 24?
Yeah, 24, yeah.
When did you start teaching?
2011, 2015, so four years later.
How many years?
Four.
Four
so
years.
I became a teacher at 28.
Okay, yeah. I have so many questions. How did you go in 4 years from a bit of school English to deciding, yeah, I want to learn this, to then 4 years later feeling confident enough to teach that language? That's quite a short time. What I want to dig into.
Yeah, sure. In 2011, my English wasn't, you know, it wasn't zero. It was, I would say, B1. Okay, so intermediate. I could understand non-native speakers of English really well. And in 4 years, I did so many things. Every day I would do something. Every day, like watching, listening, writing. I wrote essays just to write. I watched TV series. I used to watch the Ricky Gervais show, the animated
podcasts.
Yeah. TV series. I watched Breaking Bad twice with subtitles, without subtitles.
Mm-hmm.
Also living, of course, I was living in English speaking countries, and I would always listen to what other people were saying. How they were saying things. And this was a good thing and a bad thing at the same time, because when you listen, you know, to the grammar of the sentence, like I would replay the sentences in my mind and analyze the sentences, because grammar, you know, I was good at grammar. I studied it. That was good because in a way I could actually see the words being spoken. But on the other hand, I would be, you know, I was a bit too self-conscious maybe when I expressed myself. I never suffered from a huge, you know, fear of mistakes, like, oh my God. But even when I spoke, I would replay also my sentences and say, okay, I've just said this. Is this correct?
A lot of more monitoring than you would like.
Monitoring all the time. All the time. Yeah. But this didn't really impact my fluency. Mm. Not to, you know, not like some students that I've seen. Like I'm thinking of Japanese students who, you know, as soon as they make a mistake, that's it. That's the end of the conversation for them. Japanese is just not to, you know, not to, what's the word, discriminate, but because that's my experience. I've experienced that because I taught Japanese students as well. I just poured my soul into it, into learning, because I had a clear goal, a very clear goal. I wanted to teach.
You wanted to teach. I was going to say, what was the goal? Yeah. So when did that become the goal?
As soon as I realized that I could teach it. Like as soon as I realized, I discovered the CELTA certificate. Like, okay, so the CELTA certificate, because I don't have a first degree. I don't have a bachelor degree. Mm-hmm. So I thought, well, I could never teach English. But then when I saw that certification, that course open to non-native speakers as well, no degree required, just, you know, good level of English. C1 was the minimum requirement. I thought, wow. So, and then realizing that the CELTA certificate could also open doors in real language schools, not just, you know, finding people online. Thought, wow, this could become a job. And it lasts 1 month. It's an intensive course, which was very intensive, of course. That gave me motivation. Like I saw the enlightenment. I don't know.
Okay, yeah, I can see that then, because it feels, I love as well you mentioned that it's open to non-native speakers, because I think there is this, I don't know the word, kind of a stigma or a prejudice about the idea of having a native speaker teacher. And what does that even mean? Like, you know, you could have someone who is completely bilingual from birth, or but they've never maybe lived in the country. Like, what does it mean? You know, it's tricky to grasp. So yeah. I love that it's available to non-native speakers who can also, there is such a benefit to having non-native teachers of a language, because they have learnt that language in the same position that you've been when you're a learner, as opposed to from birth and, you know, as a child, et cetera, where you sort of pick it up more than actively learn in the same way. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So there's a real advantage there. Okay. Yeah. I can see why that would be such a goal. So day to day, you've mentioned some of the different activities that you did. Day to day, what was the kind of short-term motivation? Because that's, you know, it's a longer-term goal. How did you keep going to get to that?
Well, first of all, being aware that my English was improving, realizing that you can actually express yourself better than 2 months ago. And realizing that you're still not there. So I'm not there yet. I can't express like I would express myself in my first language. So noticing the gaps between where I wanted to get and where I was at the moment.
But still seeing also, improvement.
And also seeing, what you did before. I think this is true in anything you want to achieve, not just in language learning, right? If you're motivated to get to your goal, but you don't see any improvements, like you don't see that you've grown, so that could be discouraging, because you think, I'm doing all this work for nothing, so you don't see any progress. But I could see the progress, because I could feel it. I could feel that, you know, learning a new chunk of, you know, a new phrase or a new way of saying something, discovering words. Also, listening helped me a lot. I still learn words by listening. So if you use a word that you that I don't know, and I've seen maybe that word 20 times in books, the moment you speak that word, it clicks immediately.
This is really interesting. I think maybe the last episode was definitely the last interview where I was talking about this, about things that don't instantly work for me. And for me with listening, I really want listening to just work like magic on its own, but I need a visual to go beside it. So I'm always like so intrigued when people are like, yeah, just listening and hearing is thing and it works. That's so cool. Because everyone is so different. This is why I like to have guests to hear those different stories, you know? Did you try anything that really didn't work for you?
What didn't work? Vocabulary notebooks. They never worked for me. Mm-hmm. Like taking notes, not really. Even when I did English courses, taking notes didn't really help me, because it was more, you know, interacting with the people, listening to the teacher, seeing things.
Yeah.
But writing things down, it's just funny because it's, I love writing. That's the other thing. How come I love writing, but I don't learn by writing? I don't know. This is a question I should ask myself now.
Yeah, that is interesting.
Yeah, writing helps me with the thinking. Like, mm-hmm. if I want to write something, if I want to research something, if I want to clarify some of my own ideas, and I write, when I write, I, you know, it's a way of thinking. It's an extension of my thinking. I think this is true for any writer, maybe. I don't know. But yeah, so vocabulary notebooks didn't work. What else didn't work?
What did work for vocabulary?
Again, okay, I used vocabulary books. I did all the exercises because I love doing the exercises, you know, the filling the gaps.
Mm-hmm.
It was like doing crosswords for me. It was fun. But for vocabulary, listening, again, it's again that one. Reading also. Reading, because I would read quite a lot as well. But the moment I hear a word spoken by a real person, that validates, you know, it clarifies all the doubts, first of all, that I have about that word. Because, okay, if that person used it, and it sounds good, and no one is looking at this person like, what did she say? So yeah, that validates. Yeah. Let's see if that word actually works. And if it does, then okay. So it clicks, as I said.
Uh-huh,
so
uh-huh.
listening. And I was lucky in a way, because I was in a native English, in a English speaking country, right?
Yeah.
So being surrounded all the time by Australians, New Zealanders, British people.
Yeah, yeah. Good. I mean, that immersion in itself on its own is never enough, right? You can be in a country and just not be engaging or taking stuff in. What did you do specifically during your time in the UK, Australia, New Zealand to make the most of that immersion, to make the most of those opportunities of being there?
Yeah, I stayed away from Italians.
Okay.
Because I didn't want to speak English. Italian. But as much as possible,
if you met someone in New Zealand and they were like, "Oh, I'm Italian," would you, rather than be like, "Oh, me too," would you be like, "Oh, I'm French"?
No, but I have a story about this. I actually told this story on my podcast. When I was in New Zealand, I had an Italian friend there, and he wanted me to come with him to play football, soccer, and with other Italians that I didn't know. And he tried once, he tried twice. I said, I don't want to come. Like, I didn't say why, but I wanted to stay away from, you know, the Italian group because I felt also when I was abroad, I didn't feel Italian that much anymore. Because I was on the other side of the world. It was a new, you know, relatively different culture. But then I said, yes, okay. I said, yes, I'll come. And I met the Italians. They were all like loud and, you know, very different from people from New Zealand. But there I realized, okay, I love these people. Like we went for pizza. We went for like Thursday evening became my favorite evening of the week because I would play football with them and go for pizza. And then there I realized, you know, I am Italian. I cannot deny the fact that these are my cultural roots. So what was the question? How did I stay away from Italians? Well, like this, but then when I was with them, you know, it's me. Like, it's where I come from. But in London, for example, I didn't meet a lot of Italians, and when I was with them, I would try to speak English, especially if we were speaking with other people. Like if there were Polish people, so in speaking Italian didn't. But I remember judging their English, like in my mind, and that I was a bit mean. Okay, I should say, because this is what happens in Italy. People generally judge your English because we are not good at that in general. Like we judge politicians' English, we judge the English of, you know, famous people, because we're like, come on, it's 2023. How come you still speak English with this heavy, thick Italian accent?
So interesting. So do you think the default opinion of Italians in Italy is that you're not very good at English?
Yeah.
Really?
I would say so, yes. English is not, it all comes from the way it's taught in schools.
Mm-hmm.
In the majority of schools, at least. I have my niece, and all she does is she's in school, she's 19. All she does is exercises, they study Shakespeare, things like
straight in at the deep end.
Yeah, but things that are not useful to go, you know, to have a conversation with a person who doesn't speak Italian. There's no, all the, I teach in a university in Milan, I teach online, and all the students are B1 students. None of them, like they all blame their teachers in high school.
Yeah.
For the English they have now, because the way they were taught English was disastrous, like useless.
I'm so fascinated to hear this because there is such a similar opinion here, and I feel in a lot of English speaking countries that we're bad at languages and we blame it on school. You know, myself included, I've been guilty of kind of saying that, you know, that's the reason. There's a lot of reasons, but it's interesting to hear it from your perspective, learning English and actually Italians feeling the same way that you're bad at English. Like it's interesting. It's just really curious. I wonder if anyone actually thinks they're good.
Well, I'm not the best, of course. Well, no one should say that, but I'm confident, you know, about my English. I would never say my English is not good. Well, I started it. I did a lot of things. I'm still learning things. I still love using it. I wouldn't say I'm bad. My English is bad. I have a colleague who's a polyglot, by the way. Her name is Lara. Her English is I think, way better than mine. She's Italian. But she's much more obsessed than me with English. Like, she created a vocabulary, a language journal to write down all the words that she learns. And her English, like, it's better than the English of a native speaker, I would say. Like, you wouldn't say she's Italian. You would say she's from New York, probably, because she's got an American accent. And actually, she would be an interesting guest, because she did things that I've never heard such as, you know, an interesting story, because she started learning when she was seven, by herself. Like, she fell in love with English at seven.
As you do.
Yeah, well, I fell in love, but not at seven. Like, I wish. So I wouldn't say my English is bad, but it's still not, probably, I don't know. I feel like it's enough now. You know, I don't want to, I'm not going to obsess with new things. If they come, of course, because when I write, I still learn words. When I read, when I watch, I still learn words. But I'm not, like, I feel it's enough. I've achieved my goal, you know.
It's really refreshing to hear someone say that, because I feel the same way with a lot of languages at different levels, where my Italian, for example, isn't like my Spanish, but I feel with my Italian, like, yeah, that's good enough. You know, I can go to Italy, I can have a great time, I can get my point across and be understood. Same with Portuguese, same with German. Like, I don't want to go all the way in at the deep end to C2.
Yeah.
You know, I'm so curious about so many languages that for me, I want to spend that time then looking into something else. You mentioned actually that at the beginning, your love was for learning English. Have you learned any other languages?
I learned Spanish for 5 minutes.
Okay.
And then no, only English. I tried to learn Spanish, but then I thought, I will never live in Spain. I don't feel the need to learn Spanish. I'm not into the Spanish culture that much, because it's very similar to my culture, my own culture. So, you know, I believe in letting go of goals, you know, not just because, you know, I should learn a language. Well, if you haven't started, probably it's not that important for you, I would say.
Interesting.
Mm.
So what was it that got you starting Spanish for all of 5 minutes? Was it a feeling of that you should, or was it that you wanted to?
Yeah, I was, you know, when I started teaching, if you learn another language, you put yourself in your students' shoes, in a way. So I wanted to be in their position, to see again what it's like to learn a new language. I took some Spanish classes in New Zealand, but then when I was in class, I would look more at what the teacher was doing, like, because I could tell that she wasn't a trained teacher. She was just a native speaker of the language with no real training. And I would, you know, judge again. I'm a mean person, you know. I would judge the teacher, saying, I would think, why is she doing this? Why is she giving, the class a list of words that, you know, without a context, you know, teaching techniques? I would look for how she taught Spanish. So after three lessons, I quit. So it was because I wanted to be in my students' shoes, and also to learn a new language, because once you've learned one, then it's easy to learn another one. So I thought, okay, Spanish, it's very similar to Italian. I wouldn't have to struggle that much. I bought two Spanish books, never opened them. I bought a graded reader, an A1 graded reader of Spanish. I couldn't understand anything. It was like, well,
Oh,
what's an A1?
interesting. That's the other thing I was going to ask you about it. So
Yeah, so
it
I'm
wasn't
below A1. I thought it was.
really. That's interesting because the assumption is always, oh, if you learn Spanish, Italian's easy. If you know Italian, Spanish is easy. Like you couldn't understand
Maybe
it. Wow.
easy to understand, but not easy to read,
But reading,
probably.
no.
No, it
Wow.
didn't. Yeah.
Wow. Interesting. Interesting.
So, yeah, maybe like these are the two reasons why I started learning Spanish. And then Arabic is a language that, I like the way it sounds. And I like the way Arabic people from the Middle East speak English. I love their accent. And I met a few people from the Middle East. I had Saudi students, and they were all, I went to Morocco as well. I was there for 5 weeks. I just love the way they are. Like, they're very friendly, very open. It's probably maybe, a language that I could or should, or I don't know,
There's
in the
no shoulds
future.
allowed here. No, we don't have that word should.
Okay,
Like, because there's so much of it already, isn't there, with language learning? You feel like I should learn
I
another language. I
should.
should learn it to that level. Like, just no. So
Yeah, either go for it or get rid of it.
If that's what you want to do, go for it. If it's not, no pressure. That's absolutely the way. Oh, wow, interesting. So in terms of English now, you've been teaching it for a few years, you're using it in work all the time. How is it something that you feel that you're still, I know you mentioned not necessarily wanting to improve, but do you still feel like you're learning? Do you still intentionally learn? I think is what I'm trying to ask there.
No,
No.
intentionally, no, but I all the books that I read are in English. So when I read books, I still have my dictionary app on my phone. I'm always using the dictionary. When I write articles, when I write on my blog, I need the dictionary. I'm still, I'm still looking for ways to express my ideas in the best possible way. And so is it passive? I don't know. I think it's just learning integrated with what I do. It's not, okay, today I'm gonna learn five new words. No, I don't do that. Today I'm gonna read a book and see, maybe I will learn a couple of new words. If not, maybe tomorrow. That's my approach now.
It's so interesting, isn't it, how that sort of shifts and changes as you get more advanced in a language where I'd say typically the learning does become less sort of actively intentional and more sort of like you're right, passive isn't quite the word because you're still doing stuff, but it's not the core focus to learn. Like,
Sometimes I get frustrated when I was reading a book and I couldn't understand, because I don't read fiction. Okay. I think I would struggle with reading fiction because the language is so colorful, so
I mean,
many
the default
adjectives.
advice of if you were like Harry Potter, read Harry Potter, but then all the way like wand, wizard, like that's not everyday vocab. Fiction, it's very sort of poetic license to play with language a little bit more.
So most of the books that I read, well, 95% of the book that I read are in English, and they're all non-fiction. So when I read a book that I was reading a book, a fiction book, and I was like, why? I can't understand this. How come? I've got the C2 proficiency in English. I'm a teacher. I've been, I lived in English-speaking country, and now I'm reading a book and I can't understand it. Why? Well, I mean, do I still have to learn? How long will it take me to get to that level where I can understand this book? But then, you know, there are limits.
Again, it's like you said, if it's not working, just let it go.
Exactly.
Drop
and it's not that important, you know, it's not that important. If I had to write fiction and, you know, write for like review fiction books, then, you know, okay, I need to improve my English even more. But for now, it's enough. It's enough where I am. Yeah.
And you wrote a book yourself as well, right? Based on your experience learning English?
Exactly. Yes. So the book is called Any Language You Want, and it's a collection of 18 stories, personal stories of how I learned English. In every story, I explain what's the best way to learn a language. So I tell the reader, when I was in London, I did this, this, and that, and one day this happened, blah, 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 blah. And then I say, okay, do this, you know, don't take language classes. I don't talk about English. Well, I talk about English because it's the language that I learned, but it could be applied to any language.
Yeah.
Any language you want. That's the title. Do this. So take language classes, because how can you not learn? How can you learn without taking classes? You need someone to support you. You need someone to explain, you know, you need someone to mentor you, to help you, to show you how to learn. This is how to learn a language. But in the next chapter, I tell another story about what I did in Australia, where I took no classes. I was doing everything by myself. So I say, when I was in Australia, then I tell the full story. And I say, no, you shouldn't take classes. Like, people who tell you to take classes, like, don't believe these people, because you can learn a language by yourself. Learning happens without teachers, and learning has no geographical boundaries. You can learn in your room where you are. You don't need to go to Spain to learn Spanish. This is how to learn a language. So in every chapter, every chapter contradicts the next or the previous one.
And is it every chapter is contradicting it in the sense of then it's ruling it out completely, and by the end, there's an answer? Or is it just to showcase the different ways that we can learn?
Well, there is a conclusion.
Okay.
Which I'm not going to
maybe spoil. Don't share now. No spoilers.
Well, it's not that big, but anyway, it's it's to, as you said, it's to show that there are many different ways to learn a language, and the idea that inspired this book, like, it came from my frustrations when I see YouTubers, teachers, language coaches, polyglots, who say, don't, you know, keep a vocabulary notebook when they give advice. It's good advice, of course, but the opposite of that advice is also true. So maybe you don't need to take a vocabulary notebook. And the problem with the internet, with people on the internet like me and you, when we give advice, we don't really know who's listening to us. So in the introduction of my book, I say, there are YouTubers who say, don't worry about grammar. Forget about grammar. Like, focus on conversation. Focus on speaking, because language is all about communication. When you're in the real world, you don't need, you know, you don't go in the real world doing gut feel exercises. You need to speak. That's true, of course, but the opposite is also true, because my girlfriend, for example, she has a level of English which is like B2, C1. She makes mistakes, and she says, I don't know why I make these mistakes. I know that I make mistakes, but I don't know why. If you ask me, why do you say this instead of that? Or why did you make that mistake or this other mistake? She wouldn't have a clue. So that advice, that piece of advice that, you know, don't worry about grammar, that doesn't apply to this situation because she would need grammar. Maybe now it's the right time if she wanted to improve her English. She doesn't want to, but if she wanted to, it's time to buy a grammar book, sit down, read, study the rules, and that's how you could maybe become more accurate. So this, we don't know the specific situation, and in my book I basically keep contradicting myself because you can select the situation that applies to you.
I like that structure.
It's
very central to the way that I work as well, in that when I work with people in language life, which is the whole core concept of the program, is that you're learning how to learn a language in ways that work for you specifically. So it's not me saying, have a vocab notebook, learn the grammar, like do this, 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 and this, and don't do this, this, and this. It's me giving you the broader picture and understanding of how it actually works, so that you then have the knowledge and skills to then apply everything yourself, you know? And that is so much more enriching than do this, this, and this, and don't do this, that, or that. It's like, because I feel as well, there's a danger of that then becoming very overwhelming, where you think, okay, I've got my answers from this one YouTube video, let's say, and you feel like, I'm going to try it, I'm going to give it a go. It doesn't work for you. And then you feel like, okay, I'm the problem.
Exactly. Yeah.
The amount of times that that happens, I hear this from people, you know, where they think, well, I am not a language person. And it's so, it's quite frustrating, but it's also saddening, because we are, when people say, I'm not a language person, they're doing so, they're communicating that through language. So we all have this ability, if you're able to state that fact, right? It's just, I really appreciate when someone is open to that type of contradiction, that type of, you know, not feeling that, you know, Fabio, you're not feeling obliged to stick to, this is the way, this is the system, this is the method.
Yeah, and that's why the best advice I could give to a language learner is to question all the advice they get. So, okay, they say this, let me try it.
Yeah.
Does it work? No. So next tip. Yeah. Let's see if the next thing could work. But as you said, it's true. Like now there is this thing, this trend that grammar is not important. But why? Language is made of grammar. Like it's a component of language. So why would you say don't study grammar? Learn English. Like there are advertising campaigns or schools, learn English effortlessly without studying grammar. No stress English without, you know.
But Fabio, do you know what? That messaging goes back to what we said at the very beginning about people's experiences in school.
Yeah, I was actually thinking about that because this happens a lot in Italy. That's why there could be a good, like a product that could be successful. Because, okay, I studied English, I studied the grammar in school, and it didn't work. Now, English without grammar. Yes, that's where I'm going now. True. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very, very true. Fabio, we've put the world to rights.
Sorry?
We've put the world to rights.
Yeah, yeah.
We've done it.
I hope that, you know, with this book, I'm not planning. I wrote this book because I wanted to send out this message of how I learned a language. Because in those 18 stories, it's what happened to me. I also know a little bit about language acquisitions because I then did my Delta. I'm now doing a master's degree in language education. So I also know a bit of, you know, the theory, the methods, the past of how languages were taught and learned. Now I am in this book, there is some science but it's not explicit. Like if you know what the comprehensible input is, then you will see it in the story, but it's not expressed like learn a language through the comprehensible input. Like it's all
understated.
Understated. You see, I don't have these little words here, like understated.
It might not be the exact word, to be fair, but I feel like it.
Yeah,
works
it's hidden. It's hidden in the story. Yeah.
Oh, that's brilliant. If people are listening and they're like, yes, this sounds amazing, I want to get my hands on a copy, where can people get the book, Fabio?
Yeah, it's on Amazon. It's on, they can go to my website to find the link to Amazon. It's called Any Language You Want, 18 conflicting stories, 18 conflicting lessons for a new kind of language learner. So there they can find it. It's in Kindle, like ebook, and paper copy as well.
I'll pop the link in the show notes as well, of course.
Yeah, thank you. I'm now in the process of getting out there and see what happens. I'm not planning, of course, if I get a couple of bucks for each copy that I sell, which, you know, I have to pay tax on this, on it. So it's not going to be, you know, Harry Potter or anything, but it's a good product, I think.
Oh, excellent.
Did I sell it?
I don't know. I would argue you talked yourself down. Well, thank you for sharing a little bit about your story, Fabio, and explaining about the book and the concept behind it. It sounds really, really interesting. And
thank you.
Yeah, like I say, the link will be in the show notes for people, and the link to your website as well. Is there anything else you want to add before we wrap up?
Well, you're going to be on my show as well.
Yes.
So, it'll be a pleasure to. Because I have a podcast there. It's on my website as well. It started as a language learning podcast. Then after a few episodes, I got bored of the language learning topic. So I started interviewing other people, and I now call it a personal development, real story podcast where people can, you know, find some inspiration.
Excellent.
That's it.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure to speak with you.
Thank you, Lindsay.
We will speak very soon on your podcast.
Sure. Can't wait.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.